Right now on BBC One, here's Manish Bhasin.
There, we're not even at the end of August, and it's the second round of the Carling Cup already. Most of the Premier League clubs are already in the draw now, and several will be looking to avoid an embarrassing slip-up. Former West Ham and QPR striker Leroy Rosenior joins me to run the rule over the action from yesterday and tonight. Tottenham sit proudly on top of the Premier League, and Harry Redknapp takes a strong squad to Doncaster, hoping to keep their 100% record. Having lost their last two home games and shipped in six goals, Wigan might welcome the trip to Blackpool. But then again, they might not.
We'll have all the action from yesterday's matches, including from Port Vale, where, having beaten his boyhood idol Sheffield United in the last round, this fella was hoping to see off the other half of the Steel City.
And the fallout from the West Ham Millwall pitch invasions continues. We'll have the very latest. But we start at Bluefield Road, where Championship draw specialist Blackpool took on Premier League side Wigan, with the Latics, of course, desperate to bounce back from Saturday's 5-0 mauling at the hands of Manchester United. Nick Halling describes the action.
Blackpool's only win so far has come in the Carling Cup, but with four draws in the league, they're proving hard to beat. Roberto Martinez made nine changes when the Wigan side thrashed 5-0 by Manchester United, while Ian Holloway shuffled his pack too. And the Premier League side started as if they were complete strangers. 37-year-old Mike Pollitt got the start in goal. His first task was to retrieve the ball from the back of the net, as Ismael de Montagnac found a gap at the near post. Wigan too were able to create some chances, Ben Watson curling in a free kick which Matthew Jilks didn't know too much about. Defensively though, the Latics were all at sea. Patient Blackpool build-up enabled the home side to double their advantage after 19 minutes, courtesy of Ben Burgess, although Pollitt might not want to see this one too often. The visitors' best chances were coming from dead balls, especially from the dangerous Watson. Second opportunity, this time foiled rather more convincingly by Jilks. Wigan were lacking a cutting edge in front of goal, and another chance went begging soon after. A tricky run from Chelsea loanee Scott Sinclair, but once again the finish not enough to beat Jilks. And they were punished just past the half hour. More chaotic defending from Wigan. Paul Sharner scything down Billy Clark for a nailed-on penalty. Poor old Mike Pollitt must have realised that this wasn't going to be his night, because although he saved Charlie Adams' penalty, the Scot tucked in the rebound for a 3-0 Blackpool lead at the interval. Perhaps stung by a few choice words from Martinez during the break, Wigan were fast out of the blocks. Scott Sinclair's free kick testing Jilks. And more trickery from Sinclair presented Watson with the opportunity to shoot from long range, but Wigan seemed to be short on confidence where it mattered. As the visitors pushed forward, so the gaps appeared at the back, which Blackpool exploited brilliantly on 66 minutes with a classic counter-attack. Gary Taylor-Fletcher still had plenty of work to do, but some neat footwork and a calm finish. Taylor-Fletcher's second goal in a week, Blackpool 4-up. And it could and should have been 5. Alex Baptiste sending a free header in the direction of Morecambe Bay. Nevertheless, a terrific evening for Ian Holloway. Worrying times, though, for Roberto Martinez. His team well beaten, and that opening day win at Aston Villa already a distant memory. Antonio Amaya on his debut headed in from close range for a Wigan consolation, but there was no time to restart the match. The party started for Blackpool.
Well, a case of too little, too late for Wigan. Well done to Blackpool, I suppose, there, Leroy. A terrific performance from Ian Holloway's side.
Absolutely fantastic performance. I'm sure Ian got him up for the game. It's sort of game. But Wigan, I mean, they were shocking. The goals they conceded, they were all over the place, and they certainly did look like a bunch of strangers.
Martinez made nine changes to the side that lost to Manchester United, but looking at the teams, was that a team good enough to get a result at Bloomfield Road?
Of course it's a team good enough. You look at the players that came in, Jason Scotland, a big signing from Swansea, and Myers, another big signing. Of course they were good enough, but there was something not quite right on the night, and Blackpool just took advantage of it.
Interesting, Ian Holloway said afterwards that he could tell from the way they warmed up, Wigan that is, the players, that they didn't quite fancy it. Can you kind of get that vibe just from the warm-up before kickoff?
I think you can, Manish. And I think Ian would have taken advantage of that. I mean, he would have gone out, what's the warm-up? And he would have gone out and told the players, look, these don't fancy it. We can get at them right from the start. I mean, in the first half an hour, they were 3-0 up. And it was handed to him by some poor passing by Wigan. I mean, and the keeper didn't do too well either. So I think Ian just took advantage of them.
After four draws in the league, could kick off their season, of course. Well, no wins for Doncaster 2 in the Championship, but this competition has given them their only success when they travelled to Notts County. It's rather different for Spurs, of course. They topped the Premier League and scoring goals for fun. Simon Brotherton is your commentator.
It's a big week for Doncaster Rovers. Tonight they're hosting the Premier League Pacesetters, and on Saturday the Championship leaders Cardiff come to town. Sean O'Driscoll makes five changes tonight, with more than half an eye on Saturday's league fixture. Among them, Ben Smith steps in for Neil Sullivan in goal, as he did in the first round, and midfielder Martin Woods returns after injury. Rovers may be relieved to see that Jermaine Defoe doesn't start tonight, but not that relieved. Up front for Tottenham, Peter Crouch and Roman Pavlyuchenko. Harry Redknapp's never had such strength in depth. The inclusion of Crouch and Pavlyuchenko, just two of seven changes made by Harry Redknapp here as he juggles his squad in this busy early season period. Tottenham, despite all the changes they've made, really do have strength in depth, evidenced by the team they put out here tonight. Could be under pressure for the first time. It's a decent ball in, and it's nearly the perfect start. It was a cracking shot from James Hayter. Lovely ball in there from Gareth Roberts, and Hayter so nearly finished it off. Tottenham rocking back on their heels here in the first 90 seconds of the game. The most of convincing of clearances there from Alan Hutton. Back into the Tottenham team tonight, Ledley King not involved. Of course, that knee injury that he has keeps his inclusion in the side down to about once a week. Could be another chance, and Oster with the shot. More promising play down the right-hand side this time from Doncaster Rovers, and John Oster forcing the save from Carlo Cudicini. Goals really have been a problem for Doncaster this season. It's not their general play that's holding them back, by all accounts, but just the two goals from their opening four matches. Lockwood, loose ball along that back line. Oh, it's a gift for Huddleston. Horrible defensive error, giving the ball away, and Tom Huddleston finishes with style. Well, after two early frights, Tottenham Hotspur take an unexpected lead here inside the first 10 minutes. Almost as though some of the air and enthusiasm has been sucked out of the stadium here for a couple of minutes. Giovanni, twinkle-toed approach play. Crouch finding Bentley. This is Jamie O'Hara, and suddenly it's 2-0. 10.5 minutes played, and already it is a long, long way back for Doncaster Rovers here. Jamie O'Hara scored the winning goal in the third round at Newcastle last year, and he's on target on the Carling Cup trail again already this season. Later into the centre. Cudicini's there once again to deny Oster. For the second time in the match. Flag up far side, offside. This is Kyle Norton for Tottenham. Ooh, dangerous ball. Adam Lockwood's there. Not taking any chances. And it's three. It is three. And Peter Crouch has his first goal in a Tottenham shirt. Peter Crouch, having come off the bench in each of the first three matches of the season, gets his first start here tonight. Now, was it Crouch who got his head on the ball here? Yes, it was. And it definitely is Peter Crouch's first goal for Spurs. Huddleston going up in the air, losing out. Guy looked as though he'd got the better of Bhasong there. Lewis Guy with the shot. What a good shot. That had Cudicini stretching. This is Kyle Norton. Now Giovanni. Clearly held back there by Lewis Guy, but didn't stop him. Bentley, it's four. And it's all over. Last year's beaten finalists are heading through to the third round of the competition. No doubt about it. Lovely play by Giovanni. And a sharp finish from David Bentley. Rovers pushing forward, it's Hayter into the penalty area. Oh, he couldn't quite find Guy, that looked like a handball there. Shot coming in from Woods, good save by Cudicini, and the penalty has been given. Well, the referee, Russell Booth there, I think just waited to see what happened. It was a late, late decision for the handball, but that's what it has to be for. Let's have a look at it here once again, as the ball came over, and Boateng, it's his first touch of the ball, having come on as a substitute. He handles and concedes a penalty. Martin Woods prepares to take this penalty kick now for Doncaster Rovers, and a measure of pride has been restored. Half an hour to go, and Doncaster are on the board. Lewis Guy's underneath this one. Chorluka tries to get back. Oh, and it didn't quite fall in the right place there for Hayter. Doncaster Rovers a whisker away from a second goal. This is Quinton Fortune. Lewis Guy. Fortune picking out Hayter. He's tackled by Huddleston. Now it's with Boateng. Good ball, onside. This is a great chance for five for Roman Pavlyuchenko, and it is five. Tottenham Hotspur are in irresistible form here at the start of this season. Pavlyuchenko and Peter Crouch haven't been able to get into the starting 11 this season before tonight, and both have come in and got on the score sheet here. Hayter underneath this one. There's Hutton. Fortune trying to step in, losing out, Giovanni, excellent play, Tottenham threatening once more, it's fallen kindly for David Bentley, excellent shot, rising drive, not a million miles over the top of the crossbar. Forward come Doncaster again. Awkward ball, comfortably dealt with by Hutton. The ball in from Wade Fairhurst on this near side. Can Doncaster come up with a little late flurry here? And maybe a second consolation goal. Martin Woods, who scored the penalty for Doncaster, is going to take this one. Off the woodwork, and the flag goes up this time. It's going to be a Tottenham free kick. How unlucky.
It was a great result, some good goals, but I thought they were good as well. I'll be honest, they play some great football, and we were thankful our keeper made a couple of great saves in the first 10 minutes for us. You know, when they started very bright, they really did it. They flew at us in that first 10, 12 minutes or so.
Everybody who's come to the game must have thoroughly enjoyed it. I think they were both teams trying to play the right way. End-to-end stuff, goal chances at both ends. You know, we could have been 2-0 up in the first 5 minutes. So I think football was the winner tonight.
So Tottenham's great start to the season continues, Leroy. I suppose, though, scoreline perhaps a little harsh on Doncaster. What do you think?
I think more than a little harsh. I think they did fantastically well, Doncaster. They arguably created more chances in Spurs in that 90 minutes, but they just didn't take them at the right times.
It could have been so much different. It was so different in the first what, 6-7 minutes as they took their early chances?
Absolutely. That's James Hayter here. I mean, he does everything right, but it doesn't get it into the ground. And this one, John Austin hits it fantastically well, but two great saves by Cudicini, who's just come in for Gomez, and he's showing what a good keeper he is. And yeah, Harry, I think that was a really good signing by Harry.
I suppose another thing Harry would be thrilled about today was how ruthless his players were in front of goal.
Oh, did they take their chance? And that was the difference between the two teams, the quality in front of goal. Every time they had a half chance, and there were half chances, they stuck it in the back of the net.
Interesting also, they only had six substitutes tonight because Pascal Chimbonda, who was the seventh, sealed his move to Blackburn by the time the plane landed in Doncaster. I mean, have you ever heard anything quite like
Look,
it?
I wouldn't put anything past Harry. He's always on the phone, wheeling and dealing. I think he was wheeling and dealing on the plane over there. And if he can get a deal done, he'll get it done.
Just as well he didn't need another seventh substitute. anyway, another upset in the making tonight was Stoke's trip to Leighton Orient.
Hurricane Bill made an appearance in East London, where Leighton Orient had much the better of the first half against their Premier League rivals. Charlie Daniels' free kick was deflected into the path of Andros Townsend, who missed his kick before Steve Simonson and a post denied Ryan Jarvis. Dave Kitson has stated that his return to Stoke is like starting his career all over again. He's previously said that his move from Reading was a mistake and he certainly needed a goal. He came mighty close to getting one. The game went into the extra 30 minutes and Kitson's dream finally came true with a superb strike. Orient had defended stoically throughout and it looked as if something special was going to be needed to stop the game from heading to penalties, and that's what we got as Kitson volleyed the ball in from 25 yards. Time will tell if this is the moment to kickstart his career.
So it's taken 13 months for Dave Kitson to score his first Stoke goal, but it was worth the wait.
Boy, was it worth the wait. Great strike. On his weaker foot as well. And it was totally instinctive. And hopefully, they'll get the confidence back. Get him back to the player he was. And he was a good centre-forward and a good goal scorer. And hopefully, that'll give him the confidence to do that.
He certainly came for a big fee, didn't he? £5.5 million. Now, the second round got underway on Monday when Norwich, fresh on Paul Lambert's winning debut on Saturday, welcomed Sunderland.
An energetic open game with 5 goals to add to the 15 already scored at Carrow Road this season. Sunderland's clinical finishing was the difference between the sides, Timo Tainio taking home the opening goal. Norwich made 6 changes from the side that won 5-2 against Wickham last weekend, and there were some big gaps at the back, but they were brilliantly exploited by Andy Reid. Sunderland manager Steve Bruce says that Reid's worked hard on his fitness and is reaping the benefits of his hard work, but once again he was the man over, 3-0, and work to do for Paul Lambert. Norwich played their part in a game that provided stacks of entertainment. Cody McDonald's header hit the post. Wes Houlihan with his second of the season. Any hopes of a Norwich fight back were ended only 4 minutes later. Owen Tudor Jones slicing into his own net. The drama didn't end there. Michael Spillane red-carded for his shove on Fraser Campbell. The collision between Campbell and goalkeeper Ben Anick resulted in both players going off injured. And into the Norwich goal went Cody McDonald. He's a striker and 5'10", but didn't concede any goals. 4-1.
Well, we'll have more action from tonight coming up, but first let's look at some of last night's games, starting with the match that's making the headlines for all the wrong reasons.
A poisonous pre-match atmosphere around Upton Park, culminating in the stabbing of one fan, meant that the meeting of West Ham and Millwall was never going to pass without incident. Tension inside the Boleyn ground was already at boiling point when Millwall talisman Neil Harris put the League One side in front after 26 minutes. That was too much for some Hammers fans, whose agenda appeared to feature disruption and destruction rather than the delights of a London Cup derby. For what it's worth, West Ham avoided the ignominy of defeat thanks to a late intervention from teenager Junior Stanislas, who levelled matters with 3 minutes left in normal time. The prospect of another 30 minutes of football seemed to further inflame some so-called supporters who were simply unable to contain themselves. When play eventually resumed, West Ham finished the stronger. Stanislas put them ahead 8 minutes into extra time with his second of the night from the spot. With the benefit of hindsight, the players probably shouldn't have celebrated so close to the touchline, because far from appeasing the hooligan element among Hammers supporters, Stanislas's second simply led to another invasion, which forced players off the pitch for their own protection. For the record, West Ham made it safe 2 minutes later. Zavon Hines with the finish, but this unsavoury affair is far from over. The FA is planning a full investigation into a night that shamed the game.
Yeah, some shocking scenes at Upton Park. As a former West Ham man yourself, Leroy, what did you make of all that as it unravelled?
Well, it really made my stomach churn, to be honest, Manish. It brought back memories of the games we had against Millwall back in the 80s and the disgraceful scenes then. And I didn't think those days would come back. You know, there was a racial element as well. Carlton Cole was getting racially abused. The West Ham supporters running on the pitch, being threatening. And it's just not acceptable. Not in this day and age. No way. And the way the FA reacted was absolutely right. There should be a sort of zero tolerance to this sort of thing, and they've got to sort it out.
Some people are saying, let's not overreact, but I suppose there does have to be a tough stance taken here.
There has, especially when we're trying to bid for the World Cup in 2018, and these scenes will go all the way around the world. And if people see this, there's no chance of us getting that sort of the World Cup or anything else. So it's got to be stamped on. You know, I would say even go as far as playing behind closed doors. And next time these two teams meet, play behind closed doors.
Do you actually think it will affect the World Cup bid?
Absolutely. Those pictures will be... Everybody will see them. And they'll think, oh, the bad old days are back. The hooliganism is back. And it's something that we've done great to stamp out. Let's make sure we try and keep it out.
OK, well, understandably, the FA were quick to condemn the events at West Ham last night, and the FA's Director of Communications is Adrian Bevington.
It was a disgrace, and it's not acceptable. And the fact that the media are making such an issue of it today, and we are responding to the events of last night in such a strong way, shows that we're all committed to eradicating such incidents. But we must understand that these incidents have been so few and far between in recent years that we must not let it blow us off course with where we are with tackling hooliganism. We've never said that we have solved the problem long term. We keep working at it and bringing in new measures all the time to try and eradicate it, and we'll continue doing so. The most important thing here is identify the individuals concerned. That can be done with all of the media coverage. There's a lot of people who are on camera now in places they shouldn't have been or behaving in a way they shouldn't have been. They can be identified and hopefully then put through the system.
Well, apart from West Ham, seven other Premier League teams were up against lower league opposition last night, but all of them avoided a slip-up.
Sam Allardyce made seven changes for this game, and one of those, David Dunn, opened the scoring as he pounced onto an error from the Gills defender John Nutter after only 5 minutes. It was a goal with his foot rather than a head case. Junior Hoylett, a Canadian who spent the last 2 years playing in Germany, added a second on his Blackburn debut. 20 minutes from time, the home side's hopes were boosted when Simeon Jackson was just about brought down in the area. And the same player stepped up to score from the spot to give Big Sam a chance to taste his nails again. But Morten Gamst Pedersen ended any hopes of a comeback by the League One side as he scored direct from a corner.
A bit ferocious at times in the first half, some of the challenges, but we probably expected that because we really, really committed the side, you know. And so we told the players to make sure they look after themselves and, you know, get themselves out of the way and try to keep playing the football. And the good thing from our point of view was we got the goal early on.
Burnley have kept the headline writers busy over the last few months, but last season's semi-finalists had to come from behind at Hartlepool. Adam Boyd firing the host in front 6 minutes before the break. As the smell of an upset grew stronger, Burnley pulled themselves level as Stephen Fletcher's first goal in the Claretton Blue made it 1-1. Hartlepool's hopes were raised again in extra time when the visitors were reduced to 10 men. Debutant Richard Eckersley, already booked in the first half, was dismissed for this use of the arm. But any hopes of a shot were extinguished 7 minutes later as Martin Patterson teed up Fletcher to head home his second and send Owen Coyle's men through.
Tigers boss Phil Brown made wholesale changes from the side which beat Bolton in the Premier League at the weekend, and one new face who certainly made the most of a rare opportunity was local teenager Tom Kearney, a gem of a goal on his senior debut, and no doubt memories to last a lifetime. American Josie Altidore had come on as a sub in that win over Bolton and caught the eye. This goal 3 minutes before the break won't have done anything to harm his case for regular first-team football. However, the Shrimpers put themselves back in the picture as half-time beckoned. Belgian youngster Frank Moussa with a confident half-volley, his second goal of the season. But with 15 minutes remaining, Premier League superiority was confirmed when Giovanni shot through a host of legs and a possible offside to see Hull City safely through to round three.
Portsmouth may well be known for Dickens and his tale of two cities, but recently it's been more like a tale of two takeovers for the football club supporters. Suleiman Al-Fahim finally completed his purchase of the club today, a day after they beat Hereford. Frederick Piquion blasted the opener. Paul Hart made five changes to the side thrashed by Arsenal at the weekend, and he was rewarded with a second goal soon afterwards. John Utaka slotting home number two. Nico Krankar made it 3-0 with an unstoppable shot from the edge of the area. Well, unstoppable as far as the Hereford goalkeeper was concerned. Things got even better after the break as Richard Hughes slammed home a fourth. If he looked surprised by his finish, then he probably was. It was his first goal in 5.5 years. Hereford won themselves a penalty as referee Andy Durso had judged that Tristan Plummer had been fouled by David James' replacement Asmir Begovic. The goalkeeper came close to saving Plummer's penalty kick, but it mattered not as Pompey can now start thinking about the immediate future with more optimism.
Southampton knocked Birmingham out of this competition at the same stage last season, and history started repeating itself when Adam Lallana curled the Saints into a 51st-minute lead. But the Blues began moving through the gears, and Lee Bowyer steered them level on his 500th career appearance after 77 minutes. Birmingham have lost all three of their previous League Cup ties against the Saints, but Lee Carsley made sure that record didn't stretch to four by slamming in the winner 10 minutes from time.
The last thing a manager under pressure needs is a visit to lower league opposition. But Gary Megson can breathe a little easier after his Bolton side eased past Tranmere, thanks to a goal from Mark Davis shortly before the break. But despite dominating their League One opponents, Bolton couldn't extend their lead. And Johan Elmander missed two glorious chances, although in truth the first forced a fine save from Luke Daniels in the Tranmere goal. Nevertheless, lack of firepower is a real issue. And unless Elmander can fine-tune the radar, it could be a long season ahead for Wanderers fans.
The second-string Wolves side needed penalties to see off Swindon. This was a moment enjoyed by the fans as the referee handled the ball, but oddly didn't book himself. He and his assistant had a bigger role to play just before half-time when Swindon thought they'd taken the lead. Temi Obadeyi turned the ball against the post, and when it came out to Billy Painter, he finished off the move only to be ruled offside. No goals were scored in normal or extra time, so it went to the shootout. Wolves scored six of their spot kicks in succession, and it was left to Swindon captain Gordon Greer to strike the post again to put Wolves through.
So Wolves squeezed through, as do another newly promoted side to the Premier League, Burnley. I mean, two great wins in the league for them. And dare I say, a slightly lucky win late on against Hartlepool. The luck's on their side, at least.
I think you're right. It was a little bit lucky, but they're on a little bit of a roll. And I think Owen Coyle is aware of that, and he'll want to take it as far as he can because he knows there's going to be a period where they're going to lose games. So he'll want to keep going and keep the confidence up and try and amount as many points and as many wins as possible.
Now, several top-flight managers make so many changes when it comes to this early stage of the Cup. Say, Gary Megson at Bolton. Mm. But how much does a win today translate to the squad and then maybe back onto the league for them?
Well, you saw Gary Megson put out his first team last night because he needed a win. You know, he's under pressure, I think unfairly under pressure, so early in the season. He's got the win and that will give confidence to the team.
And you saw Gillingham's game at Blackburn last night. Simeon Jackson caught your eye.
Absolutely. I've seen him a few times. He's come from non-league. Mm. I think he can go and play high. And with the transfer deadline, what, 4 or 5 days away, I think it might be one that somebody might just take a chance on.
Jules fans might be keeping their fingers crossed that he stays where he is, I think. Well, if there were no Premier League scouts last night, there was one big surprise as Port Vale proved to be something of a double-edged sword as far as Sheffield clubs are concerned. Mark Clemmit was there.
They've seen a decade of decline at Vale Park. Mickey Adams is the third manager in 2 years to attempt to restore their fortunes. Pulling off one of the shocks of round one wasn't a bad way to start, even if it was against the team he supported as a boy.
Well, there's a few family that were distraught after the game at Bramall Lane, but, you know, I've got family in the darker side of the city as well.
You've seen it all.
Yeah.
Mickey Adams, is he the man to restore your fortunes?
Definitely.
What makes you say that?
Because that with the things as he's done, I think he's going to be the top man.
Mm. Tell me something, what's it like to be a Vale fan? Stoke away up there, you're down in League Two.
Who didn't you say? Stoke? Who are them?
There'll be a decent crowd tonight, you know, and the Vale fans will get behind us. It's my first experience of a night match at the Vale anyway, and, you know, I think it'll create its own atmosphere. But, you know, we need to do something to get the fans behind us, and hopefully we'll have a positive result.
Are you quaking in your boots? They've seen off the Blades in the last round. You must be nervous as hell.
No way. We'll beat them easy.
So, Boomer, Stoke in the Premier League, you're stuck in League Two. What's it like to be a Vale fan at the moment?
Everybody in? You know the team, obviously.
After disposing of Sheffield United in the previous round, fans turned out in force at Vale Park, hoping that Lightning would strike twice. A chance here to clinch a Sheffield double, and the home side were given a helping hand, or should I say, headbutt and fist. Francis Jeffers seeing the red mist and then a red card for lashing out at Tommy Fraser. Jeffers subsequently transfer listed and heavily fined and seemingly on his way out of Hillsborough. Vale could sniff an upset and Doug Loft almost opened the scoring but for a fine save from Lee Grant. Rob Taylor's follow-up denied by a lick of paint. Just after the hour, Vale's dominance was finally rewarded, and how? Chris Taylor's long-range thunderbolt sending them on their way to a famous victory. 2 minutes later, it was two. Mark Beavers with a sloppy clearance, allowing Lewis Dodds to cross in for Rob Taylor to send Vale through, and many will be hoping to avoid them in Saturday's draw.
Extraordinary atmosphere.
Yeah, the fans have been brilliant. You know what I mean, they've got behind us, and obviously it's got behind the lads, and it's, I think it's given us that extra little bit to push on. You know what I mean, to be fair, it's probably the best we've played all season.
Third round, here we come.
Absolutely brilliant.
Start getting back to the John Rudge days. Absolutely fantastic.
What about Mickey Adams? He's not doing a bad job.
Oh, Mickey Adams doing a wonderful job. He's the future of Port Vale.
Well, it needs a boost, doesn't it? You know, it's been in the doldrums for a few years now. All the managers that have been in have tried their best, you know, on limited resources, and I'm no different. But, you know, we saw an hard-working performance there, full of endeavour, a little bit of skill as well. And I don't think that anybody could take the victory away from them.
Bring on the big boys now, mate.
As a Sheffield United fan, I'm sure Mickey Adams enjoyed that night last night. It's a terrific result for them.
Oh, and well-deserved as well, you know. And it wasn't a fluke. They played really well. And I'm sure Mickey would be delighted with that performance.
What a goal by Chris Taylor.
Unbelievable strike. And, you know, he surprised himself a little bit. Look how far it is. 30 yards. You won't see a cleaner strike this year. And, you know, the celebration says it all, doesn't it?
Now, I know Mickey's quick to point out that the fact that the sending off of Francis Jeffers didn't really act as a turning point because he thought they were in the ascendancy as it was. Mm-hmm. But Brian Laws was quick to condemn what happened here. He's punished Francis Jeffers. Obviously a veteran campaigner, he should have known better.
Oh, it is absolutely ridiculous. When you see it, it just gets worse and worse. And Brian Laws is from the... He was brought up by Brian Clough, really, in the Nottingham Forest days. No-nonsense approach. It's good to see. Look, he's fined him, he's put him on the transfer list. It's unacceptable. It's nice to see.
Francis has apologised publicly. Has he played his last game for Wednesday?
You never know. You never know. But if he is really remorseful and he got kind of reacts in the right way, he's got a chance of rebuilding his career there.
OK, let's now wrap up last night's action then, starting with arguably the form team in the whole of English football.
Leeds United maintain their perfect start to the season by booking their place in the third round at the expense of Championship side Watford. Robert Snodgrass hadn't been on the score sheet this campaign, but put that right with a pair. The first combining poise, placement and confidence to give the home side the lead. That looked to be good enough until 3 minutes before the end, when Marvin Sordell's determination brought the Hornets level. A first senior goal for the academy graduate, who probably needs a little more pace before anyone starts confusing him with Usain Bolt. But it was Snodgrass again, 8 minutes into extra time, showing Watford defenders a clean pair of heels to finish off a Route 1 move. 6 wins in a row now for resurgent Leeds.
An all-championship tie at London Road as Ferguson's Peterborough took on Keane's Ipswich. There was another Ferguson and a Clough in the stands for this one, and they saw Ipswich take a first-half lead when Tamas Priskin was given the freedom of the park to tuck this one past Joe Lewis. Ipswich are yet to beat anybody over 90 minutes this season, but they had a glorious chance to make it 2-0 when Priskin was fouled by Gabriel Sequani. The Hungarian picked himself up to take the penalty, only to be denied by Joe Lewis. That miss would prove to be a turning point. Just after the half hour, Lee Frecklington's wonder strike brought Peterborough level. The winner came just after the hour. Ipswich failed to clear their lines, and George Boyd made them pay with his third goal of the campaign. A kickstart for Peterborough's season, but Ipswich just can't buy a win. A wet night probably summed up the mood of Forest fans after their neighbours and Vale Sol Campbell across the Trent earlier in the day. It was Borough who started strongly at the City Ground, and they were ahead after 43 minutes. England under 21 international Adam Johnson surprisingly got the better of Paul Smith at his near post. The home side improved after the break and drew level on the hour. From Aaron Davies's corner, Luke Chambers timed his run to perfection. Forest's only win this season had come against Bradford in the previous round, and they secured their passes through to round three with a goal in extra time. On loan Polish international Radoslav Majewski finished this sweeping move to put Billy Davies's side through.
Two managers who've enjoyed fine starts to the season hope to embrace a long Carling Cup run at Deepdale. Nigel Pearson's Leicester opened the scoring on 6 minutes. Nicky Adams with his first goal for the side who'd won the competition 9 years ago. However, the lead was short-lived. Chris Brown drew Alan Irvine's men level thanks mainly to a sizeable deflection off the unfortunate Chris Powell. Brown clearly has a taste for this competition. He'd previously struck in Preston's 5-0 rout of Morecambe. And when he made it 3 in 2 matches this season, Preston's passage through to the third round was assured.
A morale-boosting win for Barnsley, who went into this game on the back of 3 successive league defeats and without a goal since their win at Lincoln in round 1. The match winner that night was Daniel Bogdanovic, and the Maltese striker was again on hand to give the Reds a 56-minute lead. Reading smashed 5 past Burton in the last round and almost levelled when substitute Noel Hunt saw his volley saved by Luke Steele. But a minute from time, Reading were handed a lifeline when Rob Kozluk's howler of an own goal dragged the Royals level. These two meet again in the Championship on Saturday, and Barnsley will have the psychological advantage. Coyote Odijai brought down by Alex Pearce, leaving Daniel Bogdanovic, as he did in the previous round, to send the Reds through.
Under pressure, Rangers manager Jim McGilton said his side were not good enough in spite of a win over Accrington. Some neat control following a smart move from Hogan Efrain put his side ahead. McGilton, though, is already facing the flak after failing to win a league game this season. A delightful six-man move, including a nice dummy, then set up Wayne Routledge to finish expertly to put the game out of Stanley's reach. McGilton may have bemoaned his side's first-half performance, but they put together some impressive moves in the second to see off the League Two team. Stanley did get a very late consolation just before the lights were switched off as Michael Symes was allowed to fire in.
A truly bizarre game between Championship rivals is probably not going to be remembered for the first senior goal in the career of former Scunthorpe youth player Niall Canavan. Nor will it be remembered for Stephen Dobby's third goal of the season with 11 minutes remaining. Instead, this was the match which was almost abandoned because one team nearly ran out of players. Skipper Gary Monk was the first of three Swans to see red 5 minutes from normal time following a skirmish with Michael O'Connor. Even then, the 10 men could have pinched it, only an outstanding save from Joe Murphy denying Gorka Pintado. But after that, Welsh wheels started to come off. Dobby left the pitch with a rib injury, and with all three subs already used, Swansea were reduced to 9. And the odds were even more stacked against them when referee James Linnington ruled that Alan Tait had handled, giving Scunthorpe a penalty. Gary Hooper smashed in what would prove to be the winner with aplomb. And Swansea went to pieces after that. Having already been booked, Pintado should have known better than to scythe down O'Connor. Mr. Linnington, with little option other than to brandish the red card again, despite the protestations of the Spaniard. But if that could be put down to frustration, then not much can excuse the third red of the night, Angel Rangel leading with his elbow and leaving Matthew Sparrow in a crumpled heap. That left the home side with 7 men standing. And for a little while it was 6, as Austrian debutant Bessian Idrijas broke down. Mr. Linnington phoned a friend in the knowledge that if a team is reduced to 6 players, the match has to be abandoned. That didn't happen, as stricken substitute Idrijas was forced back into the fray. An evening to remember, or should that be a night to forget, down in South Wales.
Yeah, we'll have more on that extraordinary night at Swansea in a second, but Leo, let's talk about Reading. Your son Liam's there. They lost at home to Barnsley. Mm-hmm. No win for Brendan Rodgers in the league after 4 games. It's easy for us to say the pressure's on, but, you know, you're quite close to the club for those reasons. Is the pressure on him?
Well, obviously, only the pressure that he puts on himself, but it's a massive transitional period, you know, with Steve Cotwell, who's a big, big character at that football club. Brendan Rodgers has gone in, they've lost a lot of experienced players, a lot of youngsters have gone in there, and they're not scoring goals. And also today, you know, Tommy Smith, who'd agreed a deal to go to Reading right at the last minute, has now decided to go to Portsmouth, and they're in desperate need of some goal power, and he might have given it to him. So now he's looking for a striker.
And what did you make of the goings-on at Swansea last night? I mean, it was unbelievable.
It's sometimes you get these games where you're just in discipline. And I just think that, you know, the first incident has led to more and more indiscipline. And in the end, you know, they've always almost run out of players. And, you know, Paulo Sousa would be very, very disappointed with that. Yeah, you can't win games if you haven't got any discipline.
Sure. All right, back to tonight. And here's the way the rest of the games panned out.
A shock at Ashton Gate as League One Carlisle beat Bristol City to book their place in the third round for the first time in 34 years. Scott Dobie, who grabbed the winner in the last round, steered home on the hour to put the Cumbrians ahead. Dobie was later substituted and replaced by Gary Medine, and he was set up beautifully by Joe Anionsar to take away his first goal of the season 2 days after celebrating his 19th birthday.
Cardiff have begun their first season in their new stadium in fantastic form. They've now scored 13 goals and had countless other chances. Leading the way for them is Michael Chopra. His goal celebration against Bristol's other club on Sunday suggested that his right boot is on fire. This was his 8th goal already. Dave Jones' side are at the top of the Championship and they proved too good for a well-supported Rovers side which has won its last 4 games. Peter Whittingham doubled the advantage for the home side in the second half. But Rovers, with the former Cardiff manager Lenny Lawrence, their director of football, made a game of it when Steve Elliott headed in with 15 minutes of the match remaining, leading to a thrilling denouement. But Cardiff proved to be too strong, and with 5 minutes left, Josh McGuinness, who's previously doubled up as a goalkeeper, secured a place in the next round with a close-range header. It was his first goal for the club and gave his side more reasons to cheer against their 7-side rivals.
He's just helped England win the Ashes. Now Steve Harmison is hoping his beloved Newcastle can return to the Premier League. A Carling Cup run would be nice too. And after 36 minutes, they took the lead. Danny Guthrie with a smart finish. With 12 league goals in 4 games, Huddersfield have shown they know the route to goal. And they were level here just 1 minute later. Theo Robinson with his 4th of the season. And just 2 minutes after that, Town were ahead. Again, it was Robinson with the goal. He was the player fouled by Tim Krull for the penalty. And Robinson got up to make it 2-1 Huddersfield. 3 goals in 4 explosive minutes have brought this one to life. Newcastle had gone into this one on the back of 3 consecutive clean sheets. So imagine their shock when Huddersfield got a third just after half-time. Jordan Rhodes, who's proved such a good buy for Town with an excellent finish. But a minute later, Newcastle were back in it with a superb move of their own. Kevin Nolan eventually setting up Jeremy, and he made it 3-2. Then came the second penalty of the evening, and it went to Newcastle after Shola Amiobi was brought down in the area. Like Robinson earlier, Amiobi took it himself, 3-3, and the goals were flying in. With just 6 minutes to go, Newcastle got the winner. Amiobi's header across goal picked out Kevin Nolan, and that was good enough to take Newcastle through to round 3. Great entertainment, unless you're a Huddersfield fan.
A 7-goal thriller at the Hawthorns as Rotherham United looked to add West Brom to their recent list of championship scalps. But they fell behind after just 10 minutes as Craig Beattie fired the baggies in front, although Roman Bednar, back from a 3-month ban, looked suspiciously offside. But the League Two side, undaunted by that setback, drew level after half an hour. Mickey Cummins made it 1-1. 6 minutes after the restart, though, and the hosts were ahead again through Graham Dorans. It was the Scottish under-21 international's 2nd goal for the club. But straight from the kick-off, the Millers found another equaliser, courtesy of Tom Pope. It was his 1st goal for Rotherham, a day short of his 24th birthday. There were no further goals, so we moved into extra time. On this occasion, it was the Millers who went ahead for the first time. Pope started and finished the move, and Rotherham centred a famous victory. However, within minutes, the Baggies made it 3-3, and what a goal it was. Sean Cummings provided the flair, Craig Beattie the explosive finish for his 2nd of the night. And there was still time for another goal, and it went the way of the Championship side. Simon Cox breaking Rotherham's hearts with his 1st Baggies goal. The spirited Millers kept on going and almost took it to penalties, but Dean Kiley rolled back the years to turn Nicky Law's free kick to safety. West Brom scraped through.
So the Baggies in the hat for round 3, just like Carlisle. A great performance from them against your old club, Bristol City.
Oh, great result by Carlisle. Greg Abbott is a tough job to take over from John Ward and slash the wage bill. And he's got him into the 3rd round for the first time in 34 years, so he'll certainly go down in history.
And a humdinger of a game at St James's Park. Lee Clark almost getting a win against his old club.
I'm sure he's desperate to get a result, going back up to the northeast. But, you know, Newcastle scoring goals, and I'm pleased for Chris Hughton. Nice guy, and I'm delighted he's getting some success.
All right, well, that's almost it for tonight. But we're back on Saturday night, incidentally. The Football League show's on at 10 to midnight, straight after Match of the Day on BBC One. Leroy, thanks very much. Good to see you this evening. So it's been another eventful night in the League Cup. Tonight's 7 ties, dishing up 32 goals. And a trip to forget at the seaside for the Latics as Blackpool rock Wigan. From all of us, good night.